Take a theme. A charming theme, 8 bars long. Let me count the bars for you as I play it again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now listen to this. What I've just played for you is the principal theme of the finale of Xavier Scharwenka's second piano concerto. What I played for you first was my recomposition, or rather decomposition, of Scharwenka's theme as it might have been written by someone with less imagination than Scharwenka. Scharwenka's theme, as he wrote it, is infinitely more piquant, unexpected, and amusing than my revision of it. What is the difference between the two versions? Let me play Scharwenka's version while I count the number of bars for you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The norm for musical phrases is usually 4 or 8 bars. But music that goes on for too long with such normal four-square phrases can take on a sing-song predictability about it and could have the tendency to become monotonous without the listener even knowing why. Really skillful composers vary their phrase lengths every once in a while. They stretch them and contract them, elongate them and elide them to give variety. Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Berlioz, Alcan, Brahms, and Dvorak were all great masters of this sort of thing. Certain of the romantic composers were rather addicted to square phrase lengths. Schumann was one of them, and much later so was Scriabin. They were great composers in spite of this, and for other reasons, which is not to say that they could not have been even greater had they been masters of this problem. Let me explain what Scharwenka has actually done that accounts, in part, for the humor and characteristic waywardness of his theme. I can show this to you most easily by comparing his theme with my intentionally square version of it. As we have seen, my theme is 8 bars long, Scharwenka's theme is 9 bars long, but Scharwenka didn't simply add an extra bar. He's far more subtle than that. Here are the first 2 bars of my theme. 1, 2. Scharwenka's first 2 bars are the same as mine, but then he stretches the phrase. He adds a 3rd bar, a sort of parenthetical commentary, before continuing on. 1, 2, 3. Here are my next 2 bars. 1, 2. Again, Scharwenka's next 2 bars are the same as mine, but again, he adds an extra bar. 1, 2, 3. My next 2 bars would be a logical, melodic, and harmonic continuation of my first 4 bars. 1, 2. But nothing of this sort appears in Scharwenka's theme. This part of the phrase is omitted completely, and he jumps onward to conclude the theme. Here are my concluding 2 bars. 1, 2. Scharwenka uses these 2 bars, but he inserts an extra bar between them. 1, 2, 3. Scharwenka's theme sounds very much like the sort of tunes in the Broadway musical about Jewish life in the old country, Fiddler on the Roof. Whether or not Scharwenka's theme is actually a Jewish tune, I cannot be certain. As far as I know, Scharwenka was not Jewish, though he could easily have heard tunes of this kind played by Jews in Poland, where he was born. There are literally dozens of Jewish tunes that resemble it. Prokofiev used one in his overture on Hebrew themes. Then Zum Galli Galli is another such tune. Rachmaninoff had his prelude in C-sharp minor. Paderewski had his minuet. And Scharwenka had his Polish dance in E-flat minor. These pieces became enormously popular and made household words out of the names of their composers, who grew to hate and resent them, for they were expected to play them at each and every one of their concerts, to the exclusion of their much finer works. Scharwenka's Polish dance hasn't proven quite as ubiquitous as the other two war horses, but you no doubt have heard it often without even knowing its name or origin, for it is still played in all parts of the world at dinner-time concerts to the accompaniment of clattering dishes and the swaying of potted palms. And it is still found in anthologies of music with titles such as Music You Love Best. It is the only music of Scharwenka's which has survived. I should like to hope that my recording of the finale from Scharwenka's second concerto will help to stimulate a re-evaluation of Scharwenka's very considerable gifts as a composer. I can't see how anyone can fail to be captivated.